thank you all for being here. My name is Jay Dickman. I'm your friendly National Geographic photographer. Really do want to thank you for giving me your time tonight. You could not give me anything more of greater value. I want to thank B&H. I want to thank Lexar. I'm one of their Lexar elite photographers. I've been in this business 40-something years, which is kind of amazing to me to even discuss that length of time. Good heavens, where did it go? And one thing I want to talk about here is this. I want to start this thing. Hopefully this thing will run correctly. I always hope it does. But I'm going to start this, and what you're going to see are images shot over in this first 4.5 minutes shot over the last year and a half. I always try to think of some significant, great way to discuss or to start a talk like this. And what it really comes down to is I love what I get to do. I'm amazed by what I get to do, what I've been fortunate enough to do to get in my life, do in my life. Most of my work is international travel. I do a lot of work with National Geographic expeditions, workshops, adventures, these kind of things, where I'm the geographic expert on these trips. You're seeing a lot of images from these trips. But I'll tell you what, international travel is pretty ugly these days. It's nothing romantic about it at all. And sometimes I get so tired of the travel, of going to airports, sitting back in those coach seats. It just is no longer fun. I don't want to leave my wife. I don't want to leave my home. I'm tired of being on the road. And I'll tell you what I do at that point. I go through the same drill I've always done, and I will reach into my camera bag, and I pick the camera up, and it's still this electricity that goes through me. I get to do this. This is amazing. I become the eyes for my audience. You know, we're all here. We all love images. We love making images. We love imagery in general. We're also the most sophisticated generation in terms of visuals. We're bombarded on this daily basis with images from advertisements to National Geographic to movies to all this incredibly beautiful, high-quality imagery. But the interesting thing is, look at all the images we post on Facebook and other social network sites. 99% of those are snapshots. What's a snapshot? It's an image that speaks to the audience that's in the image only, to only those individuals are in that picture. It has no voice beyond that. Versus a photograph. What's a photograph? I read something interesting that photography is seen as the new international language. We share our experience, we share our lives through photography. So this is important stuff we're doing with these cameras. I read a really interesting piece by a guy named Jonathan Good. Is he in the audience tonight? I want to make sure I don't paraphrase him incorrectly. Good. I can make up whatever I want to say about him. But he writes for this website called 1,000 Memories. And he wrote this blog in, I wrote it down, 2012. And it was a piece on how many photographs have ever been taken. Did anybody see that? It was really interesting, which made me start thinking about it. How many images have ever been taken? Well, photography, everybody, I think some of you all may know this, photography was invented at about 1826. That first image out the in France, out the window of the view from the window in Le Gras. And it's interesting because what he writes about in this piece is that since 1826 to 1900, in that 74-year period, that today we take more images in about 2 minutes. Isn't that astounding? That in that 74-year period, and I wrote this down a little while ago. I wanted to make sure I was correct on this. Oh, I wanted to point out one thing too. A lot of what you're seeing here tonight is wildlife and landscape. I am not a wildlife photographer. I'm not a landscape photographer. I'm a generalist. And this is one thing that drives me that I love about this business is the diversity of what I've gotten to do. And I've always applied kind of one theory to when I shoot, and that's that every situation has its best picture. And when you apply that to it, then that drives you, I think, to really get a powerful image from whatever you're photographing. So this interesting thing I read about, okay, so that 74-year period, we shoot more photographs now than in 2 minutes. Well, in 1930, we were shooting about 30 billion pictures a year. 1960, that ramped up to about 370 to about 10 billion. 1980, 25 billion. 1990, 57 billion. 2000, 86 billion. Today, about 380 billion images a year. We've photographed more images in the last 10 years. The majority, 10% of all photos were made in the last 12 months. We are a visual society. If I mention 9/11, your first birthday, your first pet, the Iraq War, the Vietnam War, your first wedding, some people your second wedding, whatever term I'm throwing out there, but the powerful thing about still image, still photography is when I said those terms, more likely than not, it was a still image that came to mind. Because that's how we process, that's how we think. We don't think in the linear event of a video. I love film, I love video, but we don't process that way. We think in terms of still images. Try to run a photograph sometime, or a movie, 2 minutes of your favorite movie. That's not going to happen. 30 seconds, it's not going to happen. 10 seconds, maybe. But those instant images, those still images that come up, I want to talk about that tonight. And one thing I want to talk about is my early years as a photographer. That's me on the right, if you're wondering. This is way back. It's interesting because most National Geographic photographers have come from newspaper backgrounds. And I always found that really interesting. And why? And I think really the reason is that I worked with newspapers for many years back in Dallas, and I'm going to show you some old black and whites from those days, from my newspaper days. And I think when you work for newspapers, you have this demand from just the energy of the business and the way the business is built that you're given 3 to 5 assignments a day. The editors did not want to hear an excuse. You had to produce. You were working with visual narrative, which I'll go into a lot further later. And you had this huge diversity, and it really came down to 3 kinds of work, and it was spot news, sports, and feature. Spot news was photographing life on the streets, life in general. They had to fill that gray space. This was an assignment in Dallas. I was working with a newspaper in Dallas. My assignment was to go photograph this mystical and occult festival. These two guys are awaiting introduction. Guy on the left is a firewalking guru. Guy on the right's fastest draw on earth. It's my cowboy and Indian picture. Then I started learning to use something to engage my audience. I read a great piece that when we look at photographs, whether it's in Geographic, whether it's your slideshow, whether it's your book you've put together on your trip, we give an image about 3/10 to 1/2 second of attention. You have to do something to engage the audience. So I started to learn to use graphic elements within my imagery, building compositionally. And one thing I will point out, and this is something I talk about in workshops, is about 90% of what you're seeing tonight is not cropped. I'm a real believer that you try to crop in the camera. You can't always do that, but I think it's a great discipline. I'll go into that a little further later. This kid was going, this is way back, early 70s, this kid was going to a Kiss concert. His mom's helping him get ready. Feature photography was introducing your readership to what's happening out there in your community, just life in general. And how do you illustrate my story here was back in Texas. How do you photograph? This is the entire student body for a school district. So this is my photograph. How do you illustrate that? Well, this was through feature photography. And I started learning to use humor in photography too. This guy was at a rodeo clown school in Mesquite, Texas. He was on his first day of class, and he's trying to figure out where the bull is. So you started learning to do something to engage it. And just one of those quick images on the street that you see. I remember hearing a really good photographer friend of mine say that if you see something that makes you react, if you see something that makes you go, wow, look at that, you should be photographing it. So this was, you know, livestock show parade. This was an Iranian protest march in downtown Dallas years ago. Shot this thing, went back, processed it, put it on the wire. These were back in the days of the AP and UPI machines. You'd put the images on these machines, spin them up, they'd send them out to the world. You'd wake up the next morning to see where your images had appeared. Well, I shot this on a Saturday, put it on UPI, and I'll really date myself here. I was watching Saturday Night Live that night, and Chevy Chase was doing the update news. And all of a sudden, there's my picture. It's like, wow, there's my photograph. And he said, today in Dallas, the Ayatollah Khomeini lost a contact lens. Has nothing to do with photography at all. And later on, at the end of this, I'll take questions if anybody has any. And if you ask me a question, if I lean forward and go, what? It's because I used to photograph rock and roll, so it kind of took out most of my hearing. So it was Janis Joplin, it was the Sex Pistols, and it was the Rolling Stones. But again, this is all part of that feature photography thing, Bob Seger. And one thing I started learning, too, in The Who, and oh, my gosh, and Sammy Hagar. But one thing this camera's always done is given me this confidence when it's around my neck to go places and to introduce myself, and just it kind of, it's given me this, not a false sense of bravado, but a self-certainty, like to approach people, to approach situations. He's playing at the Cotton Bowl in Texas, and there's tens of thousands of people in the audience. I just kind of had a backstage pass, so I wandered out there with Sammy on stage, and ZZ Top. But it's Led Zeppelin on their first American tour, but these are all feature photographs, all part of that component of seeing life out there, reacting to it, creating an image that's going to try to draw your image in to your world as a photograph. And a Willie Nelson picnic, oh my gosh, drunk people, crazy people, high people, those were the photographers. Then you got into the crowd. And what I love about this picture still that really resonates with me is this frozen moment aspect of this photograph. These guys are just drunk and crazy, and they're throwing themselves to the air, and there's broken glass and everything. I saw this happen. I turned around and picked the camera up and shot one frame on it. But what I love about this is you can look at the guy's face. You can look at the curvature in his body. You can look at the musculature in his arms. One thing that still photography is completely about is the intimacy of moment, and how we can look at it. We can pick it up and look at the image and share that thing and put it back down. We watch TV, we watch movies, we look at still photographs. These are powerful, powerful tools, these still images. And I'm sure this is the same Willie Nelson picnic. I'm sure this young lady is drinking water to revive herself. But something else I started doing that I really teach heavily in my own photo workshops is work with the theory, the idea that viewfinder is your canvas, that's your frame. Those are your four areas of constraint, visual constraint. You're working within those. That's what I said a minute ago, that if you go into the process of shooting, that's your world. Because I hear some photographers in workshop, I have one guy that comes to my workshops regularly, and he just does it to bug me. So I crop after I shoot, and it's like his fingernails on a blackboard to me. How do you do that? How do you see photographically? Of course, in wildlife and sports photography, you're going to crop because you don't always have access to what you're trying to photograph. So that was feature. That taught me to see images in any situation. Sports, that was one of the other, the second of this holy trinity of newspaper photography. And sports was this mayhem on the field, and it was about timing. It was about moment. And if all of a sudden you're starting to hear this term repeated, you will hear it regularly during this talk about moment, because this craft of photography is all about that. Moment trumps all. And I'll talk about equipment a little bit, and there's some issues with some stuff there. But the great thing is that sports was all about this just mayhem out there. And your job was to capture this really powerful, simple moment. And the interaction and narrative, you were building narrative in these things too. You were telling a story. Just the interaction between father and son on this race. And sometimes moment can be so subtle. It can be me looking at you and my talking to you and my flipping my hand like that. It can be the big thing of the wide receiver going up to capture the ball. Or at the end of the Texas OU game, which is back in Texas, is holy cow, that's a sacred event. And the winning touchdown and the whole game you're shooting, the whole darn game. And it comes down to one moment at the game when the game is over that tells the story of the game. So it's all about narrative, moment, sports, feature, all these play together. Roger Staubach, really old photograph, but broke his ribs, you know, on a touchdown. But again, if you walk away from here with anything tonight, I hope it's an appreciation of looking at these images and start breaking down images as to why they're working with you personally. And so much of it, if you'll do this, comes down to moment. So this is very powerful. So these two things, being able to see a picture in any situation, and then understanding the timing of moment that sports gave me, was huge. I love this picture of this guy praying after he made a touchdown. It's that simple picture and the real quiet little moment of the ball rolling off his fingertips. But isn't this just a cool sport we're all in? This is just wonderful. I love this. I love this business. So, but again, it's just boom, boom. You're looking for that peak moment. I shot NFL football for years. I've shot for the newspapers in Dallas, and then I live in Denver, Colorado, and shot Broncos for a few years. And it was interesting, just technically, something to take away, that when I shot NFL, we learned quickly then that when you're going to start stopping motion, it was 1/500th of a second minimum to start stopping motion. Anything below that started getting shutter drag. Okay, so we saw features, we've seen sports. The other one was spot news, and this is when you were photographing something you had no control over, period. just intense, crazy stuff you're photographing. So I had to photograph this butane tank that exploded, and it was getting ready to blow up really big. And I'm out there dressed like this, and I'm shooting this with a 200 millimeter. I'm not that far from it. I've started getting a little wiser over the years, hopefully. And again, just seeing the beauty of structure and composition and moment, even in these situations, to me was a great education for me as a photographer. And narrative, telling the story. This lady was in this mobile home park back in Texas. Her home got, that's the remainders of her home, got tumbled, ripped apart in this tornado. She suffered, her injury she suffered was that little bink right there. So you stay there and you watch. You're watching for a moment. You know, and almost zero of the photographs you see in here tonight are set up, because I think once you set something up, it stinks of being set up. My world is, what I love about my world is it's, you're looking for the moment as it really occurs. Then this ranch in Texas where the owner had fled the thing and all these horses were dying, and this was from a young lady from the SPCA that came out to help save them, and this horse was dying in front of her. But again, you're watching every inch of that viewfinder, because you are responsible as a photographer for every square centimeter of space in there. You're watching, you keep that camera to your eye, and I'll talk about that further in a little bit about cell phones, which I love shooting with, or your real camera. But again, this horse walking up here is a really important element in this really simple picture. And a lot of stuff you're gonna see tonight is pretty darn simple, but there's a lot of thought behind it. And then just the humorous moment of spot news back in Texas of a flood, and this guy got stuck trying to get out of his car. So again, you're trying to bring some kind of energy, some kind of humor, some kind of moment, some kind of power, something to engage your audience. Because if they don't, they're going to flip on by. When they get to my photograph in Geographic, when they get to my photograph on a website, I want them to stop and be drawn into my world. Or boy, a really tough situation. How do you photograph a police officer reacting to his buddy's death? You stay around, you wait for that moment. And one of the last casualties from the Vietnam War back in Texas with his family up saying goodbye. It's a real simple picture, but it's interesting. This craft of photography is full of all sorts of rules too. Don't center things, don't have blown out areas. And these are really, getting rules of thirds and all these things, these are really wonderful suggestions. But every single one of them is made to be broken if the image works. And that's where this craft in which we all participate, we all love, it becomes so subjective. Oh, that works for me. That's lovely. I think that's incredible. And then you get to a situation where something, you know, oh my gosh, this intense thing where somebody tried to repossess a car, and this lady came out and shot and killed the guy, and the daughter came home, and the grandmother who had killed him went into the house and barricaded herself, and the mother comes home. So you get this highly emotional scene, and then you wait there for 8 hours when they bring the grandmother out. But spot news, and you'll see this a little bit further in this group of images, but spot news, it was the same thing within sports and feature work. It taught me to see imagery within what was going on. You're looking for the best picture. And one of my first spot news events was back in Texas in the early 80s. Dallas police had picked up a 10-year-old Mexican-American youth, Santos Varicas, on suspicion of stealing, I think it was 85 cents change from a Coke machine. And they decided to interrogate this kid by putting a pistol to his head with one bullet in the chamber and spinning it and trying to extract a confession. They killed him. The next weekend, the Latino community turned out for a protest march. Rightfully so. It was my first time to see something like this, and it was a very emotional event, obviously. People were very, very upset. They met at a parking lot, hundreds and hundreds of people. They marched through downtown Dallas to the city hall, surrounded by police. They chanted, they screamed, and they marched back, and then the emotion started building and building. It was my first time to see a crowd turn into a mob. They started running back through downtown, and I'm running. This is shot with a 24. I'm running right in front of them. And they ran back to the police department. There was the city hall that was surrounded by cops, and they just started attacking these cops, 24 millimeter. And I'm right in there with them. And I was protected by this camera, right? You can't include me because I'm the press. I have this invisible barrier. And I kept shooting, getting closer and closer. It was literally, excuse me, press, can I get in here? Oh, look at that incredible moment. I was protected by this thing until this kid hits me with a chain. And I spun around, and boy, I had a temper, and I was going to let him have it. But something really occurred to me on that, and it took a while for it to really sink in. And this is, he's rebounding, getting ready to try to come at me again. But photographers are part of this fabric of what's going on. You are not automatically divorced because you happen to have this camera around your neck. You're making decisions often on when you have the right to press the shutter and when you don't have the right to press the shutter, when you have that right to invade someone's very private space at that particular moment and when you don't. But if you think about two very powerful photographs, Eddie Adams' photograph of the Viet Cong suspect getting shot in the head in Vietnam, remember that image? And Nick Hutt's photograph of the young Vietnamese girl running that had been napalmed. Those, I mean, I've seen so many heads going like that against that instant recall. But those two images have been attributed to helping bring that particular war to an early close, because it's the first time we saw the horror of what war was really about. Well, I finished shooting this thing and I had to get testify against this guy in court and all this. But again, this is all about moment. The trash can is just hitting the window and the fracture is getting ready to appear. And you always get the question, especially on geographic assignments, from people like, how many pictures do you take on assignment? As if quantity equates to quality. And my answer is always, it doesn't matter. You're going to shoot that image where you know you've got it. And you're going to do those other situations where you're going to shoot and shoot and shoot, and nothing's coming to kind of visual fruition. You have to just know when to cut your losses. Well, this next body of work, this is what I was very fortunate in 1983 to win the Pulitzer Prize in photography for, and it was from work in El Salvador. Our newspaper decided to open a bureau in Central America. I went down there and spent, I think I did three different trips over, and spent a couple of 3 months down there photographing this. I entered a 13-photograph series that was built around death squads, an election day shootout, and refugee camps in Honduras. So this was a photograph from a death squad, this area called El Playon, where death squads had been executing and dumping death squad victims. The writer and I went out there. We heard, you know, hear rumors about these kind of things, and 90% of the time it would turn out to be not true. Well, we heard this rumor that this place existed was out in these lava fields. So we drove out there early in the morning. We started walking in with our cab driver and looked down, and there's a skull laying on there with a bullet hole. And this was a death squad victim. And we come upon another body. We found 53 bodies in varying degrees of decomposition. We ran this photograph half the top half of the front page on Sunday, so the 500,000 readers of our newspaper were going to be confronted with this, even as uncomfortable as it would be. I'll just show a couple other pictures and quiet down for a second here. And boy, you're talking about a sensitive situation. I was out early one morning in San Salvador driving around. I saw this family or this group of people in the barrio of San Salvador standing in front of this house, very poor house. And I walked down there and spoke to them. And they said the death squads had executed this guy in front of his house. And they told the family that saw all this, like, don't touch him, leave him there. So they left him there all night. In the morning, they dragged his body into the house and put him on the kitchen table. And I asked permission to go in here and talk about a sensitive situation. You know, cameras are pretty darn aggressive. You know, we point, we shoot pictures, we take pictures, kind of all the terminology is fairly aggressive. And you pick that thing up to your eye, and it's a fairly invasive process. So you've really got to be, one thing I tell people, when that camera goes on around your neck, to me it's like a switch is going on in your head. I'm thinking, I'm seeing photographically. My camera's ready to shoot. When you photograph people, when you get the, it's a tough process sometimes, but when you get the nerve to ask somebody to photograph them, be sure you're ready, because if you go into a situation in which you've gotten the nerve to it, ask someone, and whether it's international or domestic, and they've given you permission, and if you start fumbling with a camera, they're going to lose confidence in you. So it really is a very dynamic situation. I was down there on election day in 82, and when this shootout occurred, that a group of guerrillas had tried to sneak in around the election headquarters and create a disruption of the election process. They were discovered by military patrol. They called in reinforcements, and it was a horrific event. There were two other photographers and a film crew there with me, and they started actually executing people in front of us. And it was a very horrific situation. This was early in the firefight. I don't have many of the photographs in because it's a very dark group of images. But Talk about where you want that protection, almost that dropping of that depth of feel or that plane of the depth perception. I think when you put that camera to your eye, when you get into these things that are so abstract. This young lady, she and her husband were in their small corrugated hut in the middle of this firefight. These soldiers are still in the red zone mentally, and they were looking for anyone to shoot, and they kicked the doors open, and they dragged this couple out, and they were going to shoot them, and cameras were in their faces. We were saying, you can't do this, and we had guns in our faces. They finally let her go. And then just a very simple photograph of a father carrying his child home who had been killed in the war. And then I'll brighten it up a little bit and get off the dark stuff. This is the last photograph in the series, and it was a young girl in a refugee camp in Honduras. And two frames on it. I use this as the ending photograph in the series. There's a white tent behind me that's kind of bouncing the light in on her. And I was talking to her, and I saw the sun coming up, and I thought, well, that'll be a nice, powerful image for this group of images. And it turned out to be a nice closing image, which I'll talk about visual narrative to you in a little bit, and these components of visual narrative. Well, I'll tell you, the newspaper, I said early on, I'm a generalist. I wasn't a war photographer. I was a photographer covering a war. And there were a lot of, and this was an appealing war for a lot of young photographers because it was really easy and cheap to get there and go down, you know, and do your chops down there and get your name known in this business. And I'd had a lot of experience in volatile situations, so I felt I was fairly ready for this. But the newspaper I was working with in Dallas, after I won the prize, they wanted me to go on to Beirut, become a war photographer. And it was very appealing because I think, honestly, that adrenaline probably is similar to heroin. And I'm not being facetious. And it's addictive ability. Because when you get into something where everything's out of your control and it's dangerous and you're still getting images that are powerful, that are of your style, it's a very heady process. But I didn't want to do that. I felt like I didn't want to be, and I'm not dismissing war. There is so much amazing work being done in the conflicts today worldwide. But I didn't want to go into that for a lot of reasons. Very close calls there myself and friends that were killed and all this. But I decided to start doing other type of work instead. So I started working with New York magazines. I started working with an agency here in New York and started doing work on other types of photography. So this was shot for Fortune magazine, Hazardous Materials Training Center in Colorado. They have these derailments set up. They set off the explosions. They get students from governmental entities, sheriff's departments, fire departments, etc., teach them how to work with these hazardous spills. I'm out there dressed like this. This guy is in an outfit like that for a reason. Shows how smart us photographers are. And you know, even with digital presentation, one thing I suggest to young photographers, when the iPad came out, it was amazing in this industry because on the dead tree publications, newspapers and magazines who are all losing numbers, everyone started looking for a platform via which they could present their publication. And the iPad came out, oh my gosh, it was amazing. But still, even on covers, we think of covers as verticals, still. So you have a nice space up there to put the name of the publication. This is a Mosquito Indian, old Mosquito Indian, Nicaragua, sitting by a little bitty fire. Now, for you, if any of you are photo students and you remember, exposure is cumulative. So this is a 45-minute exposure. This guy sat there forever. I didn't ask. He didn't move, thank heavens. But if the exposure builds and I'm doing some technical stuff to darken the sky. But it's got the nice space on the side. This was used as a cover and all this, so. And this is in Dubrovnik. It's just a nice little moment. It's a mother carrying her child down the street. And I saw this and I just fell in behind and click, click, two frames. But the point in this is I read a study done once on what we look for in photographs. One of the very first things we look for are eyes. Then we look for diagonals. Then we look for sharpness. But when you have eyes in a photograph, you force an engagement with your audience. When you have the catch lights in the eyes, you bring energy into your subject. So eyes are really, really critical. Now my family travels, you know, my family puts up with my work because they've gotten to go with me over the years. So this is a picture of my son in Grand Cayman. I did a shoot for a magazine on Stingray City. You can go swim with the stingrays. Now this photograph even has a moment. Anybody venture a guess on this? It's him touching the stingray. Moment doesn't have to be in your face, loud, grab you by the eyeballs. It has to bring energy. It brings a connection possibly between the subjects. Far western China, Kazakh, watering his horse. I was winding around this beautiful late afternoon, saw this guy watering his horse, picked the camera up, shot a frame. He looked up at me. I shot this frame. He waved at me. I waved at him. Moment was over. But again, I'm watching carefully all the edges of the frame because I don't want any distracting stuff up here. I don't want the edge of the mud coming in or anything like that. Again, you're responsible for everything going on in that viewfinder. That was a live sheep shortly before that, shooting with a long lens, Kazakhs in this traditional catch a sheep carcass game. And I'd mentioned some of the rules. You know, one of the rules of photography is that your eye is going to always be attracted to the brightest area in a photograph. It's funny because in workshops and when people show me photographs, sometimes they're so intent when they're showing me the photograph on the subject material that drew them to it that they're not looking at the edges of the frame. They're not looking at what's going on elsewhere in the image. And I don't set photographs up, but I was photographing this Hmong family up along the Chinese-Vietnamese border. And it was this beautiful, oh my gosh, when you get fog, when you get to atmospheric conditions of rain and fog and mist, oh, get out there and shoot. It's wonderful. But you've got to be careful because in fog and in overcast, skies tend to go nuclear. They tend to go way too bright. So I'm always kind of moving. Sometimes your best zoom lens will be your feet. Move. Don't always shoot everything necessarily from your 5'7", 6'2" perspective. Move around. You know, again, you're responsible for everything in that frame, but this area up here was too bright, so I was kind of got down a little bit, put mom up there in that portion, so she kind of filled that area. You're not supposed to have a person on the edge of the frame looking out. That's one rule I read about. Well, I love doing that because I think it brings the energy across the frame. So then I'm watching her, I'm waiting for the moment, watching mom up here, and then I watch dad in the background to see when his hoe is splashing in the mud. This is a shoot on Condé Nast Traveler magazine some years ago on a group of herpetologists who go to the Amazon. This guy, Bill Lamar, wonderful guy, good friend through the assignment, but he takes amateur herpetologists on two-week trips in the Amazon rainforest basin, and we would sleep all day and get up at night and go out and look for the most volatile, nasty critters they could. And that was really fun. So on this story, I had to have kind of the sense of place picture, which is really critical. So we use this as a two-page opening spread, and we needed something to introduce our audience to where we are. This is critical in your coverage. And we had this beautiful light afternoon. I grabbed a little boat we had on board, went chasing up the side of it. This guy happened to walk up here, which gave me a nice little bit of energy up there. Now, you'll notice that this part, that's the toilet on this boat, and this looks like something out of Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness. This boat should not have been on the river because it was sinking, essentially. The toilet was under about 18 inches of water. So you'll see what happened. So anyway, so we went up this tributary of the Amazon, about 60 miles, and went to this Indian village, and we asked them if we could set our sleeping mosquito netting up in their ceremonial hut. They said, yeah. So I said, well, that's a nice picture. So I shot that. It was kind of cool. And about 3 a.m. after we went to sleep, heard all this commotion coming from down at the river, went running down there, and our boat had rolled over and sunk. And we had people sleeping on it, and they were rolled up in mosquito netting going into the river, and it was a pretty scary situation. And I jumped on, I was helping to kick these windows out here, and we were pulling some people out of the boat and all this, and there were big gasoline drums that were pouring gas all over, and the local tribe was coming down with open torches. So it became kind of a scary moment, and this is an okay picture, more of a memory picture for me. But what I love about this business that I've been so lucky to be in, 3 weeks later, I'm in the Arctic photographing the story for National Geographic on SciTex. It was a scientific program that the U.S. Navy had lent a nuclear attack sub to them as a platform. So when we were there, we knew this was all going to happen. This nuclear attack sub came up through the ice. We used a sequence in the magazine. It was pretty cool. And that was kind of the nice moment, nice little ice coming off the top of it. And I got on, this had all been prearranged, and I got on the sub and spent a week under the Arctic ice, which is really interesting. So there's just this huge diversity. And again, what I love about it is you're shooting so many different things that you're not pigeonholed into one kind of work. This is a shoot for the magazine on bat radar tracking, one of the largest biomasses on Earth. 20 million bats emerge from this cave in Texas every evening. Shooting a slow exposure, about a half second. with flash fill to kind of, I wanted these bats to be blown out. I want them to look very ethereal, but it's really combining exposure. I tell especially aspiring photographers, if you don't know what you're doing with flash, don't use it. You know, you don't use flash generally to light a scene. You use it to augment, supplement existing light. So you're bringing light in where you want to have it. Or light painting. Love doing this. One of my first shoots for the magazine, it was in Papua New Guinea, the Stone Age village I lived in. We used this as a sense of place photograph. Saw this guy walk through the village every evening with a lantern. I stopped him one evening, took a measurement, light measurement on the sky that was almost dark. When the light got perfect, I said, okay, thanks. He walked off, and as he walked through, created this nice S-curve, which is one of those great rules of photography, and his lantern light painted the front of each one of these little huts. So you're trying to do something to bring your photography to engage your audience. This is in the same story. That's a cassowary. No one can ever figure out what the heck this picture is happening. But I went with two hunters. We spent a whole day chasing this cassowary, which is one of the most feared animals in the rainforest there. They have big spurs on the back of their feet. That's its neck. That's its beak. That's its neck. It's very like a psychedelic ostrich. That's its body up there. It tastes like chicken. They're quite good. But these are dogs from the village dragging it down into this creek in the rainforest just as they were about to kill it. And then this is okay picture. I was photographing a total eclipse off the coast of Rio, and I walked out and saw this guy. And again, it's just reacting to what you see. It's like, oh, that's just a cool image. I love that. That resonates, and it tells you something about place and the person in this boat. That's your job. And like I said, the one thing that this camera's done for me is it's given me this confidence. And you've got to be careful with it today, especially. Most of my work's international, and it's not always a friendly place in which you're working. You've got to know when it's okay to pick that camera up, when it's not okay to pick that camera up, when it's not only invasive, but it's maybe culturally a taboo and you can't do it. But I was in Italy and talked my way in a little fishing boat between a couple of islands. My George O'Keefe ripoff here of a natural geothermal vent in Iceland. Boy, that's an amazing country to go to. So these things are unbelievably loud. I'm about a quarter mile from it shooting it. And sometimes in this business, you've just got to be ready. And that's what I keep saying. You've got that camera goes on, man, you are ready. So I'm in the Antarctic photographing this bergy bit, right? It's a piece of ice that sticks up 2 to 5 meters out of the water. Isn't that lovely light? Oh, that's a pretty picture. And this event happened in about 2 seconds. So I'm shooting this, and all of a sudden, this penguin explodes out of the water, gets up there, almost gains purchase, slips, falls back in the water. There was a photographer sitting by me, and I shot this with like click, 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 click. And he shook his head and turned around and said, what happened? I said, well, yeah, you have to see it. But you've got to be ready for these things. And my son was with me on a trip to the Antarctic. And he was 25 at the time, and he had a video camera with him. So I said, shoot this scene. This is a good illustration. I think part of our job as photographers is to make sense of this visual chaos in front of us. Our job is to find the element. I read a piece once that painters have it easy. Painters get to put in the frame whatever they want. We have to build the image. So what do? I use a 400 millimeter lens on this and kind of reached into the middle and just very carefully constructed the image. You know, again, you're thinking, this is what I love about photography. Photography is all about problem solving. You shoot something. If it's static, you shoot something, start thinking right away. Okay, what's good about this? How can I improve this? Most aspiring photographers, what I see is they get so zoned in to what's happening, we tend to dead center the thing. We're not watching the edges. We're not watching branches come in. Again, shoot it and then start thinking, what can I do to improve this? In moment, this is up in the Antarctic. And going back to that, what I said about NFL football. Okay, I knew that 500th of a second. I'm in a Zodiac in Arctic Ocean, splash, moving all around. 500th of a second to start stopping action. Well, I'm in a moving boat. I better double that. So this glaucous gull is having a young gull trying to steal food. And these things happen real quick. That's why they call it a moment. So I'm at about 1650th of a second trying to get this thing. And a picture in Taj Mahal. One of the great things about pollution is it gives you these wonderful sunrises and sunsets. Oh my gosh, it's just lovely. But again, it's a nice picture, but it's got a real subtle little quiet moment in it too. And that's the guy's foot kind of creating that little ripple of water around his foot. So again, you create a nice image, and then sometimes think if you can bring another layer, another bit of information in that engages your audience on a second level. It's almost a Where's Waldo thing, that you create a photograph that's lovely and it's pretty, and let your audience get to part two of it, part B of it. That's that Where's Waldo image. So one thing I want to talk about, I think that's what's coming up here, is what I carry in my camera bag. I always get this question. So I am sponsored by a company. I'm not going to go into that. But I believe in the mirrorless revolution. I'm a big believer in this. So what I carry is this camera, and I carry, that's a 24 to 80. That's a 14 to 28 with me. That's a 80 to 300 2.8. And I carry my doubler with it, or quarter 1.4 converter. Then for low light situations, I carry a 24 f2 equivalent and a 150 1.8 equivalent. And it all fits into a bag this big. And this is huge today with travel photography. And what I love about these mirrorless systems is that what I used to carry was a big honking camera. And now I'm carrying this little bitty thing. And I output it to 30 by 40s. I'm a really good printer. And I love people that argue with me that I need a full-size sensor, because I'm using a small sensor. And my argument back to you is that, well, if you're going to buy into that, you really should not be shooting just a full-size sensor. You should be shooting a medium format sensor, because that quality is going to be better still. Well, let's take it one step further. Maybe you should be shooting with a leaf back, a 4x5 shutter format. Every camera is a compromise. You find what works for you. Now, I'm going to get on my soapbox a little bit here. I'm sponsored by Olympus. By Lexar, I'm sorry. And I'm here tonight for them. A lot of my work today is with Geographic Expeditions. I'm on these trips. People buy onto these trips. And it amazes me when I see people come on these trips and they've spent thousands of dollars on this trip and they spend thousands of dollars on equipment. Then they decide, I'm going to save money and buy a cheap card. I'm going to save 10 bucks and buy a cheap card. And then they have card failure. Who would have thought? So one lesson to think about is, don't do a lot of racing in camera. Card companies, Lexar techs, have told me that exacerbates card error issues. Don't, and you're making decisions over images on a very small monitor. Don't do that. I love these new cards. They're very, very fast. This is something to think about too, that if you're into wildlife or sports photography, you want the greatest speed. You don't want the card's buffer to be what limits your shooting speed. So I'll be glad if you want to come up to me, I can explain that later on this. But this, you know, there's a reason you spend the money on this stuff. And cards, and something else to think about, it's kind of funny. Lexar provides it. They provide an image rescue software. Because a lot of cameras that you buy out there, when you hit that format card, and don't just erase the card, format it. Because when you format it, you write a new directory file to the card. And it helps the camera and card interface better. So, and a lot of cameras actually don't erase anything when you format it. All it does is it writes a new directory file to the card and says, you can write over all those images. I had somebody come up to me once. She said, oh my gosh. Said, we had card error. Oh my gosh, the whole trip. And I said, let me help you out. And so I said, let me take your card. So I plugged it on my computer and started the Lexar recovery software. And it churns away for a while. It takes a little while. And I thought, well, I'm going to check her pictures out and make sure it's okay. And she thought she'd formatted the card from old times. And she, all of a sudden, I was looking at pictures that were like, I don't think she wants me to see these pictures. So be careful what you shoot, because it's not always erased. But going on about equipment, I love my cell phone. I've got it with me. I shoot pictures with it. I think Apple's campaign is just brilliant right now with those amazing images that they're producing. But I really think that if you look at those images, that they're lovely, they're beautiful, they're compositionally gorgeous, palette-wise, everything else. But I think there's a slight distancing of intimacy of structure and composition and moment. Because you're holding that viewfinder out here. And I should love shooting with these. So you're holding it out here and shooting. And you've got this chaos of stuff going around you. And sometimes, like I said, moment can be that little bit of thing of my flipping my hand up, my looking up like this. And that's awfully hard to see when you're holding that viewfinder out there. So I'm a real believer putting the camera to your eye. And now I see this. There's companies making, I shouldn't say this, B&H here, but there's making lens kits for the cell phones. you're starting to defeat kind of the purpose of carrying a cell phone, because you've got this whole lens kit. So you've got these pants on. They're like Bozo the Clown, because you've got a big enough pockets, and you're reaching in, you're putting lenses on. This is why we shoot real cameras. So I'm going to kind of go over what I carry lens-wise. You know, the absolute immediate availability of a cell phone won't give you. Love shooting super wide. That's when you get into the 8mm, 16mm, that kind of thing. This was shot in Dubois, Wyoming last summer at Milky Way, coming up over a tree. I'm light painted the tree just barely. It's 2400 ISO. And I'll give you a very cool rule to think about when you're photographing on long exposures. There's a rule called the 1/500 rule, that if you take the number 500 and divide it by your lens length, that it gives you the approximate number of seconds, maximum number of seconds you can make of that particular sky full of stars before you start getting star trails. Because we've all seen the star trails, and it's cool when it's a full one, but if you get partials, it really doesn't work very well. So that 1/500 rule works pretty darn well, because I'm at 55 seconds on this, 2400 ISO, and I've got just enough definition. If I'd gone a little longer, you would have started to have a little bit of streaking. So anybody recognize this place? Davis Monthan Air Force Base in Arizona. It's where the U.S. military sends all of its retired aircraft. I'm shooting from a helicopter, and it's nice when your client has a budget for a helicopter. I love shooting from them, or a climbing harness. I take both back doors off. I have my preferred aircraft I like flying in. But I'm shooting this with a 14mm. It was there the afternoon before, saw this incredible place. This was for Life magazine. They wanted to do an eye candy two-page spread. That was at one photograph we won from this. So I got the helicopter, got up the early morning light. But again, this is full frame, and I'm really careful, because if I'd gone up a 16th of an inch at the top, I would have had open field. That would start to break down the imagery. And again, when you're shooting, just be so cognizant, aware of what's going on in the edge of the frame. But these are 168-foot aircraft, and I wanted it to look like a field of toys. And then super wide in Namibia, it's an okay picture, but you put that super wide on the ground, you get that desert floor reaching in, and then you start working the situation. I'll talk about that a little further. So you're shooting that. We're shooting probably about a 14mm there. Then you step into wide angle. And it's interesting. I read that our eyes see it about 32mm, like a lens in 35mm format. So this starts kind of getting into that how we see stuff. In Namibia, again, at this incredible desert they have there, but now things start compressing a little bit. You start bringing the value, your layers of information together when you start shooting this length. One thing to think about when you shoot, I love doing, you know, if anybody took like Art 101, one of the basic things was the color wheel, complementary colors. When you look at that color wheel and you have warm colors versus cold colors, and when you bring those colors together, we make images that resonate up here. They're appealing to us. So this is back in Wyoming. It's late afternoon. And boy, I'll tell you, it's a magical time of the day to shoot after the sun sets, before total darkness, when you can combine these light sources and you've got that balance. But that balance occurs just for a few minutes. This was a Maasai in Ngorongoro Highlands overseeing his cattle. It was a 20-second frame, 20-second exposure, and during the exposure, I've got a little flashlight, and this guy was really thinking, like, what is he doing? So I'm standing there, and, you know, I was just watching him, and during the exposure, I'm just barely painting his face to bring the light value up on him, but to have that exposure on the stars and all in the background. And I chased this darn llama for an hour around Machu Picchu, because I thought, and I wanted to have a photograph, and now we're at about a 24mm length, and I wanted a photograph that would have foreground-background information. Because aperture becomes a technical component, but it's also an aesthetic component. So I'm shooting at f11, finally got this darn thing corralled. I never hurt my animals, but I wanted the background, foreground, and focus. So I'm about f11 at 24mm, because I wanted all that information in there. Then Tibet. And again, I find that photographing people is amazing to me. But if you're not comfortable with it, I promise the first time you do it, when you go up to ask permission to photograph somebody, they may tell you nasty things, to do something physically impossible with a camera or whatever. Don't take it personally. Just just keep up with it, because people love seeing people. And I'll talk about that a little bit further in a bit. But the importance of eyes in India, in a small village, but just to get that simplicity and that beauty of eyes. Then we step into what's been always considered normal, 40 to 60, which is kind of contradictory when we think about the whole idea that we see at 32 millimeters. And so here, I've got the camera at ground level, and it's got that little live monitor thing going, so I'm able to watch this penguin, and its eye, and I've got it off-center, kind of working rule of thirds. The Ironman Triathlon, I love, and we're at that very comfortable length of 50 millimeters. You get a lot of information. You're not compressing stuff. You're not distorting stuff. It's very comfortable for us to view, but a layered image like this brings our eye up and through the photograph. Now, one of the rules of photography is don't center your horizons. Well, I think it, great suggestion. If it works, it works, though. And a lot of those darned impressionistic painters got away with it for many years. And I'm photographing these penguins coming out of the ocean in South Georgia, and I'm putting and I've got a wonderful sky. So I'm able to bring the sky, and I've got it split just about dead center. But this is a really carefully composed photograph, because I'm making sure that I've given some breathing room down here. I've got this nice S-curve. I've waited for this one little guy back here to catch up. So I've got the breathing room, but again, you're responsible for everything going on in that frame. And in Baja, Mexico, where you go to see the gray whales, and I thought, wow, how cool to see it from a whale's perspective of these limbs coming into the water trying to touch them. So it's kind of love this simple interaction between those two. And then you get the half in, half out photograph for the whale. And we do a workshop in Smith Island on the eastern shore of Maryland. And you get that light, that wonderful light when the sun sets, not total darkness. This is about a second exposure. 1600 ISO. I've got a street lamp right here that's illuminating the front of this old building. We had this hydrostatic surge during this last storm in September, October, but it's just blending those forms of light as you shoot. Then we go into the short telephotos, 85 to 105 in Namibia. And I, once in a while, will use a polarizer to enhance the color. Shooting for publication, you cannot manipulate, which is one other thing I love about what I get to do, because you really have to execute the image. You have to accomplish it in camera. But a very simple S-curve picture. And did you ever think you're at the wrong party? And these are king penguins in South Georgia, and these are called Bokum boys, or the young ones that haven't matured. This one is matured. I've got it off center, coming across. And again, right up here, it starts to get to, there's mud in there. You've got to be really watching it carefully. Scale plays a part in photography in Iceland, Black Sand Desert, that this gives you an idea of how large this thing is. You got to be careful. Because if you've got a boring, solid color sky, you really don't want to have it a lot playing in the photograph when you're doing landscape. So I'm doing a shoot for Geographic on national parks in Great Smoky Mountain National Park. So in a helicopter, nice budget there. And I got rid of all the sky up here, and I had this wonderful foreground, background information going on. And we don't always have the luxury to shoot at the best time of day. So I'm in Western Africa photographing this, and I'm using this harsh, harsh light to create this triangle, kind of pointing the interest to the net guy pulling the net out of the water. You use what light you have. What's the best light to have? It's the one that you're given at the moment. Then we get into telephotos, 105 to 300s. And then you can start using the creativity of aperture. Well, I want to shoot open wide, so my background drops out of focus. This, again, is in South Georgia. And the skua is looking over its smorgasbord of 250,000 penguins out there. But I wanted the emphasis to be on the bird. So I shot wide open so that the background dropped out of focus. Same thing, shooting a long lens, compress these birds in the Baja, taking off these Heerman's gulls as a raptor flew over, but compressing everything on one plane of focus. And Garden of the Gods in Colorado has a nice little moment of the guy pushing out. But the great thing about these lenses is it lets you accomplish what you see up here when you press the shutter. ladies who were part of a voodoo tribe in Western Africa, in Benin, I think it was. And I love this woman's eyes. They're just amazing. I sat there for 20 minutes waiting for this kind of this choreography of their of these ladies' faces. And I was sitting there watching, waiting for this to come together. I'm shooting with about a 300 millimeter. But I've got this these wonderful eyes, this lovely almost repetition of form. And then her expression going out there kind of pushes our vision out the frame. Then we get into those super telephotos. And you don't have that on your iPhone, you know, when you really want to reach out, you're up in Glacier Bay and you want to photograph the big bull sea lion that's come out of the water and the moment with its roaring at the its harem below it. And when you shoot an assignment for Geographic, it's wonderful because you go, oh, great, they give you every inch of rope to hang yourself with. But about 85%, 70 to 85% of your contract is research. So that you know what's going to happen. You're putting yourself in the field as knowledgeable and you can direct the story, your visual narrative as powerfully as you can. And I was in Alaska. I knew that, you know, bald eagles, when they're on top branch and they want to take off, they really have to pump their wings up. So I kind of sat there waiting for that at a high shutter speed. And this is in Africa earlier this year, just a pride of lions, but using that super long lens. And again, it's nice because those long super telephotos compress everything kind of onto one plane of interest. And cheetah in Namibia, and I could have shot it at a high shutter speed and captured it in frozen, but I thought, well, I love the fluidity and motion of a cheetah. Let's drop it down. And I found for panning photographs, generally where you get the movement and the blur and all that, about a 30th to 50th of a second seems to work really well. And as this cheetah, and I'm shooting this with a 600, and as it's going by, I'm hand-holding it, and I'm at a 50th of a second, and I'm focusing on the cheetah's chips or cheetah's hips, because that's where the power in the cheetah comes from. Or 1,000 millimeter in the back in the Antarctic, and this huge iceberg that these penguins were waddling across. But the penguins, this thing is kind of tapering off this way, but using that super long lens puts it on that one plane of interest. And then you add those little characters down there, and it gives scale. Where are we now? We are in, oh, good, good, good. When I shoot a story for Geographic, or anytime I shoot two or more frames of anywhere on my trips or whatever, I think, or when you do it, you and I both enter that world of visual narrative. We're telling a story. So when I shoot a story, I've broken it down years ago that there are really five components of this visual narrative with which we work as photographers. The first thing you have got to do, you have to bring a sense of place to your audience. Nothing worse than being in a friend's house on a Friday night and they want to show you 1,000 pictures from their trip to fill in the blank, and you know by four images in it's going to be a brutal evening, versus that individual that understands a concept of narrative, of less is more, and they show you 40 images of this place, and you know what the place looks like and smells like and feels like. So, and I put some technical information in there if anybody's interested. But sense of place tells you, illustrates how wonderful this place is. Oh, God, I was in the Antarctic in the Grand Didier Channel, and the sun came out in this late afternoon. It was just ethereal. Your image can convey that. Or you're in Namibia, and you get this incredible sunset, and you're always playing it. But sense of place is critical for your narrative. Or in Egypt, it's taking your audience and saying, look at this. And this is what we do as photographers. We share our experience through imagery. You know, what we do as photographers is dealing with narrative. Same thing a writer's doing. We just happen to write with light in Smith Island. But again, you know, you're looking at the subtlety of a little complementary color, the wave and the orange glow and then Chesapeake Bay Area. But shooting really wide angle, I love shooting wide, but sense of place, again, tells your audience why. This is a different picture from Du Bois again, but that amazing Milky Way. This is one exposure. You get these skies out there. And if anybody's interested, I put a list out there. Feel free to sign up for it. I'll send you my First Light Workshop mailer. And also, if you're interested, I'll send everybody a resource guide that's hot linked to all the stuff I use. And this is a very real world list. So they've got them out there at the desk. And then light painting, that simple thing of that, you know. So I'm in Easter Island, there's a Moai heads, real boring picture with this incredible Milky Way coming up behind of silhouettes. So, but the simple thing in this 2-minute exposure, you get a cheap as possible flashlight and you light paint it. and just you kind of go like this at that speed over this thing, 2400 ISO, couple of minutes, and you blend it nicely. I did a thing in Patagonia last year. My daughter went with me, and we stayed on to do a two-week hike in Torres del Paine. I told her we'd get her picture in there. But again, it's sense of place. And you bring the human figure, the human element in there. We love seeing people. And this is, you know, and we relate to it that much more readily. See how important even just watching the gesture of her legs are in there? Photography is about moment and gesture, kind of one and the same. Shoot I did for Geographic on Tachinchini Alsek, but these were used as openers, as introductory images to this. Angel Falls, you know, photographing that. Oh my gosh. And then, you know, I'm in a helicopter. It's like, let's get closer and look at Angel Falls from a whole different perspective. But you're sharing with your audience why this place is special. Far western China, Kazakhs driving their sheep up during the winter, during the summer months. But again, these are, and you notice that sense of place generally are the big, broad images that are expansive, kind of let you breathe when you look at it, takes you into that place. We do a workshop in a small village in the mid-Pyrenees of France. So there's this planted forest across the river. Went over there, shot a few second exposure, like, oh, lovely, lovely, lovely light. Work the situation. If you've gone somewhere, think about, well, how would this look if you came back the next morning? It's a whole different image. And then work it. You lose, use a longer lens to get in there, but work these situations. So shot a couple of weeks ago in Millennium Reef in the South Pacific. But it's, again, sense of place image. Friend of mine in Galapagos, diving with a fish. But again, it tells us about the place. Oh, this is a shoot I did for Geographic on Yukon River. So I shot this picture, and it was the birth of the Yukon. It's a horrible reproduction. That was from slide film. But I really like this picture because it was important to me. I thought it told the story well. One of the other Geographic publications called and said, oh, we love your picture of the birth of the Yukon. We want to use it as a cover. And it's like, oh, that's cool. Yeah, cover. Everybody's going to get to enjoy this picture. Look at the subtlety of tone. Ooh, look at the gradation from here to here. Oh, look at this. Everybody, I'm thinking everybody's going to get to really enjoy how this looks. And this is what happens to it. That's the reality of publishing. But these sense of place are critical. What's the next thing we do? We introduce your cast of characters. So I keep saying people love seeing people. So I'm in India photographing this beautiful woman, early morning light at the Taj Mahal. I'm photographing this lovely Imba woman in Namibia. And I've got a reflector in this horrible mid-time of day light. And I've got a reflector going and all this. But stay with your subject. She walked outside of the hut. And I think it made a more relevant photograph, telling something about her landscape, her place, their hairstyles, the tradition of the mud braids they create. But this guy, I photographed him. He's been sending me emails. Oh, Hakuna Matata, how are you doing, Jay? But in Tibet. And again, these are all introducing our characters. Critical stuff. We love seeing people. It doesn't have to be people. It's the wildlife. But what we're doing is we're saying, okay, here's a sense of place picture. Now let me introduce you to your characters. Here are those that make it up. This was shot about 3 weeks ago in Niue in South Pacific. It's a banded sea crate. They're about 10 times the toxicity of a cobra. And I'm out there swimming with them. And there was about seven around me at one time. And they said, oh, they're not aggressive. But they said, watch out for this particular kind because they're really aggressive. So, and I started watching this. I got a little nervy as I was shooting it and got my nerve up. And I would watch them come to the surface, and they'd lift their head up around and look around. If they saw you, they'd just go down and they'd flip their tails up in the air. So I got up to this one. This is shot with a 14. It's got a housing. I'm shooting with a housing. So I got up there and bumped the snake. So it would react. And sure enough, it did this cool thing. Then I started thinking, well, what? They said, don't tick off a banded sea crate. What exactly is it that ticks off a banded sea crate? In South Pacific, a couple of weeks ago, again, a bunch of barracuda, but this is introducing our characters. These are critical pictures for your narrative. And I think if you start thinking of applying this template, it creates a better body of work. It doesn't dismiss great photography, anything. It emphasizes it. Far western China, again, a couple of kids, they were terrified I was going to tell their mom they smoked. friend of mine in Dubois is sitting by a campfire, and it's again, it's using complementary colors. I've got the late afternoon light. That's not snow. It's just late afternoon light on a beat-up old hat. And Buck is sitting around this campfire, and he's looking down. And by not having, I kind of sat there and waited till he looked down, because if it had his eyes, it would have been about him. Now it's a generic cow person. There he is again with his daughter. And I have nothing against Buck's eyes, but like to me, his daughter's eyes were really cool in that. Back in the South Pacific, a gray-headed penguin, a gray-browed albatross chick, I'm hanging off the side of a cliff. But now what we're doing, we're getting into environmental portraits. And environmental portraits tell you something about place. So I've got the chick here. He's trying to figure out what I'm doing. I'm hanging on this. There's a 100-foot drop-off right here. And this background's really important information. We know this is not Kansas, probably. Tiananmen Square in China. But again, these character pictures, character studies are really important. And I think at times your portraits can be almost not too tight. Close to where you get this bear hunting guide up in Yukon Territory. Incredible eyes and you've great wrinkles and lovely soft light. When you get that overcast light, it's just wonderful to shoot in. A nice little moment of the cigarette smoke coming out of his mouth. Sri Lanka, this lady, just this quiet moment. Use that long lens, you let that background drop out of focus. Begin, some of these technical components become creative tools for you. Then you step into an environmental portrait. This guy's in Leningrad, a young comedian, awaiting introduction at a comedy club. I just love this intimacy of moment of him. And I love shooting under tungsten light and shooting on daylight balance. Or in my raw files, I almost always open it up as daylight because I love the warmth that this light can provide. And a young Maasai walking up out of Ngorongoro Crater. But just waiting for these moments, and you stay with it. Sometimes you have to even regain your inertia. When you're shooting something, and you feel like you've got it down, you put all your equipment away, then you turn around, it's like, oh my God, there's the moment. You've got to get everything back out and shoot. This is a Hadza hunter-gatherer in Tanzania, one of the most ancient lines of humans on Earth. He's awaiting out the midday heat in this incredible tree trunk. And I just love this kind of quiet moment. But again, it's introducing us to these people. Weddings, oh my gosh, you can't go wrong with weddings. And foreign, especially Europe on Saturdays, you're guaranteed, everybody's in a good mood. Come on in. I can't tell you many parties and households in which I've been invited. Far Western China, this young lady was to be married. Great subject materials. Like I said, people are in a good mood. They're very receptive. And I did a shoot for Old Life magazine on this oldest postman in the United States. This guy was in Wyoming, and I spent a couple of days photographing him, and kind of like nothing was happening photographically. You're always trying to get that energy, trying to figure out your narrative, figure out your direction on the story. So we're out. It's the last day where I'm with him. And he said, well, my last drop-off is about 2 miles down the road. And I said, well, let me run down there. So I went down there, and I thought, huh, this would be cool. I'm going to put a flash in the mailbox, and I'm not going to tell him. So I did that, and when he got up there, I shot one frame, he fell over. No, just kidding. But again, the main light is the background exposure. That's my key, that's my main light. And all I'm doing is introducing light where I want your eye to eventually go. So we use light in varying ways, but it's all about photographing people, working a situation. Again, it's a tough one. I try never to pay for photographs, but there's areas like Marrakesh in Morocco where these people are in the souks. They are there. That's their business. So I'm winding around the edge of the souk, and I see this old guy sitting on the edge of the street. He was a beggar. Sat down with him. I ended up paying him money. I said, may I sit here for a while? And he said, yeah. So I sat here and just kind of watched him for a little while. And I'm really carefully framing the picture. I want to make sure there's no trash cans or anything in the back here. And just working this situation, trying to capture kind of the essence of who this guy is. And one thing in imagery, in photography, in painting, and imagery in general, we like asymmetry. We don't like things necessarily dead center. So I'm photographing this guy in Egypt, midday light, horrible light. But I waited minutes and minutes for this situation to kind of build because I didn't want there to be vehicles on the road. Because if there's vehicles on the road, it dates the image. So I stood there and waited and waited and waited, and finally all came together, so we have three layers of information going on. What's the next one you do? Detail. This is a critical one. You force your audience to engage in a way of seeing that maybe they had not thought of before. Landscape is made up of all this minutia of detail. Photographing this horse in Arizona, and I saw this fly buzzing around. I thought, if that landed on its nose, it'd be so cool. And again, it's kind of one of those Where's Waldo photographs. Bunch of dead termites in Namibia in a mud puddle. I thought, that is so cool. Like, it looks like a painting of some kind and along the Greenland coast, but it's detail. It's detail. And again, you kind of tell your audience, let me take you in and look at this. You hadn't seen this before. And silly little picture of a flower. But it gives you that idea of what this place is made of. So you're taking, again, your audience by the eyeballs and saying, look at this, look at this. And you don't have to open with that sense of place picture. You can open up with the detail, the elephant's eye in Cambodia. Guess what kind of bird that is? Blue-footed booby, yep. Or ice in Alaska, boring picture. But that detail gives you information. In Galapagos, a sea turtle. Waiting, I sat there for 20 minutes by this tidal pool waiting for it to stick its head up. Got two frames on it. But also you try to bring an image to the plate, to your readers, to your audience, that maybe is a new way of seeing. And that detail of a penguin with the pin feathers and all this, and then this king penguin coming out of the water in South Georgia is like, look at that detail of that water, it's just amazing. But that detail, again, often in that detail, your audience is going to feel like they can almost touch it. And a different way of seeing baby gray whale come up out in Mexico. But again, you're trying to do something to grab your audience. What's the next one? It's moments. Oh my gosh, moments are so cool. That's where you bring the power of the story in. Yukon River story I shot, U-Picture, seal and whale hunting. We use this as an opener. This was a complete mayhem situation. These boats going around, they're fishing and hunting in traditional methods with atlatls and harpoons, and you get that power, that guy getting ready to harpoon a seal as it's gone back under the surface. Du Bois, Wyoming, running the horses early morning. And that, I love that little bit of extra light right there. But moment brings power to your audience. And these... In Spain, building the casillas, the towers of humans. And so you get that great moment of them building the foundation for it. Then they build the tower and they send a 10-year-old kid to the top of that thing. And sometimes it collapses. This penguin exploding out of the water, high shutter speed again. I knew I wanted to freeze that. So I was at that shutter speed. Or that quiet moment of a wedding in Italy. And If you have windows or if you have doors in pictures, make sure there's often something going on within that portal, because we kind of see it as an opening to somewhere else. Back in Du Bois again, but just I love that light when you get that backlit dust. It's like incredible. Friend of mine riding, doing that panning thing, but it's about moment. It's about bringing that power. And then shot a few weeks ago in South Pacific, this kid jumping in the water, shot that half in, half out picture, underwater housing, shot with a 14. Trying to bring something to surprise your audience, because you're going to pull them into your world when you do that. And boy, you got to be ready for this. When these penguins porpoise through the water, they are just blasting, just a wonderful way for them to travel. You've got to be just, and then kind of an ugly picture of a leopard seal disengaging a penguin chick from its head. But I'm sitting in that shot with a 260mm, I'm from here to Deborah, from that thing. It's just going through them like popcorn. And then just one of those, you've got to have that camera up. I think Wayne Gretzky said it, you're going to miss 100% of the shots you don't take. And that's not saying just machine gun stuff. I'm saying you've got that camera up to your face. You're watching for the moment. You're ready. Want to bring this. This is work in a situation again. So I'm up on this thing in the Northwest Passage. And we get out on a Zodiac raft. And we're in this heavy Arctic seas. And they're moving us all around. I see this iceberg and... It's kind of a boring picture, but it's like, God, that's just beautiful light. Look at that light. This picture's not there, not anywhere there. So I start working it. So I'm like, well, that's lovely. Well, that's, look at this. That light's just incredible. And I'm seeing these waves build, and we're just all over the place. It's like, well, what's that famous, the Japanese Habasake was, I can't remember his name, that did the amazing wave pictures, but I'm thinking like, wow, this could happen. So I'm working the situations. Nothing's really coming to visual fruition. Well, I can see that there's promise. Not there yet, but you stay with it, and you need to know when to cut losses or when to stay. So I'm working this situation. Oh, the wave's nice, but I'm getting flipped all over. It's not there. oh, wave's very cool, but I've cut the top of the darned ice off. So then kind of everything comes together where you get the power of the wave. I'm shooting a high shutter speed because I want that wave to be frozen. I've finished off the structure up here. I've allowed this. I'm using that incredible light in the background. So stay with the situation. Work the moment. So what's the last thing we do? You close your story. Every other, those other four components, sense of place, detail, introduce your characters, moment, can be interspersed however you want. You can open with a moment, you can open with a character. This one you kind of got to put at the end, closing your story. So you can be really stinkingly obvious. You get the, oh, we ended our vacation in lovely wherever, and the sunset and our happy travelers went home. Or you can try to make a more interesting photograph. I'm photographing cowboy artists in Colorado, and I'm walking back to the campfire, and they're all sitting around with this cool campfire, and we ended up using this as a closer photograph for this thing. And then chasing a marine iguana in the Galapagos. Just kind of what a closer does is it ends our story. It takes it to fruition. We're wrapping it up. This was shot at Punxsutawney Film. We're the only, Phil, we're the only society that bases our weather prognostication on a rodent. But we use this as a closer on this weather story. And back in Smith Island, a variation on that, but mixing those light forms. But it just closes our story out. They're usually very simple pictures. They're often late or early. They kind of visually take it to an end. This is 222 seconds in Torres del Paine of this river flowing through. And you get that super long exposure. You get that ethereal looking water that some photographers don't like because it doesn't look real to them. It looks surrealistic. But it's just an ender. This is in Du Bois again. This amazing rainbow that occurred that just takes us out. Okay, our story is over. Borneo, earlier this year, Bali, one of the two, but going down this river at late day with this shooting, golly, 1 second, 2.8, 1600 ISO. But I'm just wrapping things up. Back in the Galapagos, sea turtles, it swims away. And I think that is the final one, but I love this quote by a local New Yorker that you may have heard of that I think really says it all about this craft of photography. If we could bring the house lights up, if anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to. Are there any questions? Oh, we've got a microphone. There's some way back in the back, of course.
I got one here.
You mentioned how you're limited by the protocol at National Geographic or wherever about what you can do to change the image. What's hard and fast, and what do they allow? Can you shade someone's face? Can you clear out a stick that's coming out of the hockey player?
No to both those. And it's interesting because I think really in some contests recently, there have been contest winners that have been disallowed because people went, they took things out, they added things. You cannot do that at all. You cannot change a face. You cannot remove a stick. And that's what I'm saying. It really forces you to engage with the scene. So you're moving constantly. You're thinking, what am I going to photograph? But you can bring the image back color-wise to accurate colors. You can use a highlight shadows tool within, your raw reader to bring the highlights down, to open up the shadows, to about what it would be in reality. But you cannot manipulate, you cannot remove, you cannot add things. And it's interesting because in film days, in contests, the rules were very hard drawn, or we thought they were. But I remember in black and white film days, you'd print and you'd darken the edges of the print to bring the attention to the subject. Boy, you can't get away with that anymore. There was a image that won. It didn't win. It was a photograph earlier this year out of Syria, I think, of a soldier diving, a freedom fighter diving to the ground, and the photographer who took it, I think he had a reporter friend with him, that a video cam, tiny thing, you hardly even notice, it fell into the frame, and the photographer removed it. He cloned it. You didn't even hardly see it, but he just decided to clean it up a little bit. Well, AP apparently decided to enter that photograph in a contest, and the photographer mentioned to him, he had done this, and I believe he was fired from AP. So the lines have been drawn very, very severely. There was a winner last year in World Press, I think it was, of a group in the Middle East carrying a child that had been wounded in a conflict, and the photographer had brought it about to the maximum of the corrections of what he could do with opening shadows, bringing down highlights, brightening and darkening certain areas. And there's a lot of discussion over the legitimacy and the validity of that image. So it is, you cannot do anything to take away from the original content. Does that make sense? But you can use software to bring it closer to what it was when you pressed the shutter. I hope that fairly answered that. Yes.
Hi, thank you for your presentation. I was wondering if you could share with us what you think is the true purpose of photography, or the true meaning of its existence, or
the true meaning of, that's a great question. What is the true? I think it's to allow us to share. You know, photography is kind of memorial in its intent. You know, we forever freeze things with our cameras. God, I mean, you look at this project Harvard's done with this Digital Imaging Institute, Harvard, not Camden, but anyway, Oxford, to photograph historic sites, because so many of these historic sites and relics are being destroyed worldwide, and they're training people how to record them 3D so they can at least physically replicate those treasures photographically, and then someday we may be able to reconstruct it. Well, we also do that with still imagery when we're photographing people, because we're forever freezing this moment so future generations can share. That's what that moment was at that time. Look at that. That's history. That's a frozen moment of time that we're sharing forever forward. So I think the intent of photography is to just record kind of the human condition in its varying degrees and colors, for future generations, for our own generation to share, but it's also to explain what's going on with our culture and our good and bad aspects of our culture. So I think it's a very powerful tool of sharing, educating, illustrating, and archiving our history. Hope that addressed it quickly in a long, that's about a 4-month answer.
What was your criteria for going to black and white in some of those pictures?
What was my criteria? A lot of the criteria for going to black and white in those pictures is I was with a newspaper that in those days, that's all they wanted, was black and white. So I ended up shooting, it was all Tri-X in those days. And we had the choice often of some early days newspaper in the early 1970s was almost all black and white. We do color once a week on the cover, and the color always looked, it was so bad, it looked like huevos rancheros on a piece of paper. It was really ugly, but as the reproduction level increased and the demand from the audience, when the newspapers and magazines started realizing the competition of TV and the other electronic forms of presentation, they had to take it to that level of creating something that we were more probably visually comfortable with. So, but we would have the decision, if at all possible, to shoot black and white or color, but often the black and white was dictated by simply, this is what we're going to run. And when I started shooting color, especially with Geographic, it was all slide film, which has very, very little latitude for error. So that taught me exposure, which goes off onto a whole different tangent. But it really, so to answer your question specifically, it had to do with their needs at the time, and later on, kind of how I felt it best conveyed the story I was trying to capture. Does that answer that close enough?
Hi, I just wanted to clarify whether the millimeters. Am I just hearing that echo?
No, no.
Okay, whether the millimeters listed refer to the actual or equivalent.
That's a good one. It's like when I was talking about the lenses equivalent, what I was showing was what I always think most people are most comfortable with, and that was 35 millimeter equivalent. Everything I shoot with mirrorless is 2:1. So sometimes I would catch myself, even in this talk, like saying, oh, I shot that with an 8 millimeter. Oops, that was an 8 millimeter in mirrorless, which is a 2:1. So it's a 16 millimeter equivalent. So it's what you see with that 16 millimeter, but it's a depth of field of the 8 millimeter because you're still shooting that true 8 millimeters. That answer that?
Mr. Dickman, you mentioned that you have to be wise in certain situations that are sensitive, dangerous, or emotionally charged in knowing whether or not you can shoot. Can you provide any insight into your decision-making process to decide whether or not it's appropriate to use your camera?
That's a good one. Yeah, a lot of it comes down to when you're in a very volatile situation, just a basic safety. If you pick that camera up, you may get very, very negative response. There's some situations culturally where it's very offensive to take photographs. If I see a situation on the street occurring and it's a great moment, I'll probably react to photograph it. But I'm also always aware of the appropriateness or the not appropriateness of culturally in that place to shoot it. There have been situations where what you're seeing in front of the camera is amazing and you know you just can't do it. But you're making that call. So I hope I'm answering that question for you. But you're making the call based on all that criteria going into it. Look at this. Oh, this is a very, very powerful, incredible situation, but I just can't photograph it. Or there are certain danger levels to photograph it, but it's an important narrative to take out to your audience, like when you're in El Salvador. And there's those other situations where it's just, it's run of the mill. So it runs the gamut. I think it's also just a lot of the experience that you bring into the business after years where you photograph those. Like I was saying, when I photographed El Salvador, I think I took a certain amount of experience with me, comfort level and everything else, that I felt like I was safe in that situation, even though it was really volatile and had a lot of potential danger accompanying certain situations. So there were things that I backed out of where you just knew you had to get out of it. I got myself into a couple of very ugly situations that I was able to get out of. But it's just, I think the most simple answer is just taking that knowledge that you've acquired and kind of bringing it all to the spear point when you're out there photographing it, when you're out there shooting something that's very sensitive in whatever level or multiple levels that you could be doing that. And just making those calls when it's appropriate or not.
Hi, Mr. Dickman. You mentioned that the composition is very important to get it right in the camera the first time. I'm just wondering, though, in terms of the getting the right aperture and the right film speed, and is that something that just comes with experience? Do you have different techniques you use for each type of shoot, and so on and so forth?
Another excellent question. I think a lot of it comes down to experience. I think a lot of it comes down to knowing the situation you're in. Wow, this is this particular thing that's going to be moving. People say, well, what's your favorite shutter or your favorite exposure mode? Well, I do manual a lot, or a lot of my work's about moment, so it's shutter priority. But going in, to me, everything about photography is about moment. So I think technically, I'm going from that level. I will sacrifice a bit of image quality to go to a high ISO, because I think if the image is powerful, you relate to the image. You don't think, if you're looking at the image and you're going, oh, that's so noisy, look at that grain, look at the noise, then your image is not working powerfully enough, because a very powerful image is going to work on many levels. When you look at Steve McCurry's photograph of the Afghan girl with the green eyes, you don't look at that image and think, oh, I wish he'd shot that with a 135 instead of a 105. I wish he'd shot that with Kodachrome 25 instead of 64. You look at the image and you go, oh my gosh, look at that. That's just so powerful. And that's what this craft is supposed to be about. It's getting that image that resonates so powerfully that I don't care what you shoot a picture with. It could be with an Instamatic, it can be with a Holga camera, it can be with a 4x5 Linhof, it can be with whatever. When you get that powerful image, you look at it. I hope I'm answering this because it's a really important question. And I go off on tangents, but I think about the picture from the British subway bombing several years ago and the young lady in Iran that had been shot during the student riots. Those two images were shot with cell phones. As much as I tweaked about cell phones, But those, again, those are such powerful images. You're looking at them from that level, and it goes down to an emotional core. It goes down to just such a basic human core that you're reacting to the image. You don't care what it was shot with. So when I shoot something, I think part of it is, like I kept saying on this talk, is you have to go into it thinking and seeing photographically. Like I said, when it's to me, when that camera goes around my neck, it's a switch that goes on in my head. And I'm walking into a situation, and kind of one of the first things I start doing when I walk in here, I'm looking at the slide going, wow, this is at about a 30th of a second over in this spot. That's about an 1/8 of a second at 1600 ISO. And it is, yes, a lot of it is just shooting for, I've been in this business 40 years, 40 plus years, and I've shot a lot of images. And hopefully I've learned something over that, and it's to understand light, to understand the limitations of what the camera can do to the light, so you're always working the situation. And I think being a good photographer makes you enjoy seeing everything better, because you're looking at it photographically, you're looking at light, you're breaking it down. Look at this light, look at that light, look at the contrast range, all these things. So I think knowing your equipment is critical in this. Knowing your equipment so well that it gets out of the way. It's invisible. It's a conduit from what's happening out there to what's going on up there. It's knowing the exposure so well, so you walk in like, well, I know what this exposure is. I know what the light balance is in here. I know what the limitations are. I know what the benefits are. I've got a hot spot over here. But it's understanding it so well, and it's also understanding all the rules of photography so well that you know when you can break them, and you've got that comfort level. So it really is a thing of, and I suggest to everyone that you look at a National Geographic that rings your bell, or you look at go to an art exhibit somewhere and you see those photographs, that when you see those photographs that blow you away, start breaking it down. What's working in this? What's this photographer done on this? You know, I see layouts I've seen with Holga cameras, which if anybody doesn't know what that's a, and they just went out of business, I heard, but you know, it's a $50 plastic camera made in China. There was 620 film or 120 film, one of the two. And most of them are so poorly built, you have to tape the darn thing shut. And I've seen people, photographers collected them, and they'd sand the lenses to give a different look. But I've seen layouts done with those in Condé Nast and other publications that the images are astounding. They're just amazing. So that's where it becomes such a personal, subjective thing on what makes an image work and what doesn't, what makes it not work. And having all that information, being, again, so comfortable with it that the equipment gets out of the way, that all it's about is what's going on out there. And I almost always work with two cameras, and I use a wide-angle zoom and a short telephoto zoom. And I think I'm actually minimizing what I'm carrying by carrying those two cameras, because I don't generally carry anything else. And then you think back to some of the great photographers, Cartier-Bresson and Danny Lyons and Robert Frank and Maxie Avenue, and these people that were doing things with, Maxie Avenue was large format, but they were doing things with essentially one 35 millimeter lens. One 35 millimeter lens. And look at what they did. And now we have, so I think by minimizing what you carry and what you're shooting with, you maximize the photographic potential. Because you don't have a whole bag full of, well, I've got an 85-1.2, a super fast specific lens that I'm looking for pictures for that lens, instead of just out there on street photography or whatever, and you're reacting to moment. So I hope that gave some insight to that. So did that answer that partially? I always carry two cameras. The question was, do I carry more than one? Yes, I always carry two. And that's what I love about this mirrorless system, is that the stuff is so unobtrusive. And without getting on my bandwagon, that I think that you have to, if you do a lot of international work, which all my work is made of these days, carrying equipment's becoming a nightmare today worldwide. It's becoming a nightmare. Eight airlines earlier this year signed an agreement, an accord amongst themselves, that they were going to further reduce the carry-on size of what you could take. So that's what I like about this smaller equipment. I've got my whole kit in a little bag like this big. It goes on the airplane with me. I don't ship it under the plane. I'm not going to ship my equipment under the plane. And the other thing I love about the stuff is, what's the best camera to have in your hands when you need it? It's a camera that's in your hands when you need it. What's the best camera to have? It's one that's in your hands when you need it. And that's what I love about this stuff, because I'm carrying this stuff. It's not in the way. I love the big main manufacturers' cameras, but they're just, they're lovely. If I were shooting high-end sports, NFL football, I may be shooting with those still. But for me, the small equipment that is also less obtrusive and less, especially in a world today where you're out there and it's, you're often seen as a financial target. So the less I can play that part, the more photographic opportunities I have. And the more I look like a dweeb, the more I look like a nerd off and somebody, he's not real. Great, that's where I want to be. I want to be as invisible as possible. So did that give some insight to that? Anybody else?
Yes, my question is about when you were in Salvador and you were taking pictures of war photography, how did you deal with the psychological effect when you were taking the picture and then when you were working the picture?
How did I deal with?
The psychological effect.
The psychological effect? That's a really good one. I think that's something you cannot dismiss from people who are photographing that, because you are often seeing things that are so volatile and so ugly and so horrific that I think that's what I said earlier. I think once you have that camera to your eye and you're dropping that dimension of depth, I think it takes you a little bit out of the reality of it. So what I say, when I photographed that riot, I was untouchable because I was a press. I had that camera to my eye, then I got quickly dragged back into reality. Well, I think when you're photographing those situations that are so horrible, where people are being executed, killed in front of you, I think that slight physical perceived removal of dropping that dimension of depth possibly allows you to remove yourself somewhat from the situation. There was a Pulitzer Prize winning photograph shot years ago, I think it was in Sudan, of a child starving on the streets with a buzzard sitting behind it. That young photographer ended up committing suicide. This is a lot of baggage you carry with you of what you've seen. And this is one of the other things that I really thought I didn't want to commit my life to, photographing these situations, that I wanted to be more the generalist. I wanted to see the diversity of everything on this globe. But I didn't want to immerse myself in that dark side that deeply. So I think that's a really relevant question. It's something I think every war photographer, everyone photographing those very volatile situations has to deal with. And it's interesting, if you go to the museum in Washington, D.C., which I hope you will do it, it's a wonderful museum built around news gathering, and they have a section on the first floor built around all the Pulitzer Prize winners. And they actually interviewed several years ago all the living Pulitzer Prize winners. And it's amazing in that you can go into these little kiosks and press the year and hear the story behind the photograph. And it's amazing when you see these, how many photographers become very, very emotional talking about what they photographed and what they saw. This is one of the most insulting things you can call a photographer. One of us is, don't take it personally, anybody's here, but a paparazzi. I'm not a paparazzi, I'm a photographer, with a full set of feelings and emotions that you cannot just dismiss and put aside when you're photographing these things. So yeah, you are dealing with these emotions. And like I said, I brought up the idea of Eddie Adams' photograph and Nick Utt's photograph, these extremely powerful photographs that are horrific, but that had huge power and long legs to continue that narrative, that important narrative, to an audience on down the line.
One last question.
I'll keep it real simple. Do you still shoot anything in film? And if so, what type?
Great question. Wow, do I shoot anything in film? You know, I'm a person of the film world. I love film. I just love the feel of it. I love the texture. I loved having learned in film because of the discipline, the methodical aspect of film, and the discipline that accompanied it. I view as critical for me as a photographer. So I don't shoot in film anymore. I've still got a Leica at home that I pick up an M6 every now and then. It's like, golly, that's just beautiful. But when it comes to shooting, it's all digital. And I think early on, it was a great argument in the digital world in the early 2000s. Golly, that seems just like yesterday. Oh, my God. But film outdid digital. Then it's all moved to the point where digital can at least replicate what film can do. I'm a film person. I love film, but I think that the power that digital gives you of being able to make that image look like it did when you pressed, in your mind's eye, when you press the shutter, is how much more power do you want? I saw a famous war photographer who I highly respect, oh my gosh, Don McCullen, talk about he didn't feel that digital was valid. And I argue highly with that, that this is about using tools to replicate what you saw in your mind's eye. Well, I don't want to manipulate pictures. Well, don't manipulate pictures. That's very easy. But this is about image making. And I said, I don't care what you create that, make that image with. It's about the moment. It's about using the technology to get that moment, to get that image that you can share with your world, you can, whatever level it is, and that it speaks, takes, provides a narrative. So I want to thank you all very much for your time and attention. I appreciate it greatly.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.